Welcome. We were waiting for somebody to introduce us, but we're just going to get started. So thank you for attending our panel discussion from Communities to Crisis. We are really glad to see that there are people from various courts that care about outreach and care about communications. It's a vital, important function in any court system. Just want to introduce myself, and I'll have my fellow panelists introduce themselves. But my name is Jeff Fatah. I'm the Communication Director for the Utah State Court System. And I'm going to turn it over to my other two esteemed colleagues to introduce themselves as well.
Hello, everybody. I'm Craig Waters. I am the Public Information Officer at the Florida Supreme Court. Job I've had for almost 33 years now. I've done a few things through the years, like dealing with the press during Bush v. Gore. Back in 2000, if you remember that little ruckus when Florida couldn't quite get its election right. And I've done a few other things since then, Terry Schiavo, for example, a few school voucher cases and stuff like that. But we do a lot of communications outreach at the Florida Supreme Court. We also handle crisis communications quite a bit because Florida always seems to be in a crisis. So I'll be happy to work with you on that. Thanks.
This is very high tech because we couldn't figure out how to do this earlier. But. There's the play button.
To see the inner workings of something that may have been very confusing to them, it was broken down into a way that I feel is very useful to students. I think it's very good idea to get students exposed to as many different career choices as possible, especially ones that they may have a potentially negative mindset going into it.
Everybody, welcome to Fabulous Las Vegas. I'm the PIO for Las Vegas.
And it was a great experience for the children. They got a chance to.
All right.
And as advertised for this conference, what happens in Vegas does end up in court. What ends up in court usually ends up in the media. And we're going to get to that. We're going to help you out with that. But right now, we're going to start out with the fun stuff, which you got a little glimpse of, outreach. What outreach is, it's an investment in your community, and it's an investment in your relationships. And there's an old saying, relationships are like bank accounts. You have to make deposits before you make withdrawals. And that's very important, and that comes in down the line when you get into a crisis. But right now, what I'd like for you to do is I'd like for you to just take yourself out of this conference room and think back to about fourth grade. Let's go back, fourth, fifth, back in the day. Did you ever go on a field trip in fourth grade? Show of hands, who here went on a field trip?
Probably.
Okay, show of hands, who here remembers anything from that field trip?
Who wants to share?
Do you remember anything else from, show of hands, does anybody remember anything else from fourth grade? No one. Op one. We had one back here. You want to share your memory from fourth grade?
I remember that one of my classmates had a sleepover and I wasn't one of the persons.
I would have invited you. Yes.
It's lasted my whole life at the parent-teacher conferences. The teacher said, David has such potential. And I've had to live with that because I'm not sure I've ever actually fulfilled any of
it. Okay. Well, the point being that field trips have a big impression on kids. Generally, that's one of the few things people remember from when they're in school. And we do programs, we do a lot of programs that are for young students, and it's an investment. You're building a new generation of citizens, and it's an investment in not only your community, but when you get into a crisis, you have that investment of a relationship and the relationships that you build during outreach.
So, I mean, that's part of the exercise is making sure that we get part of the low-hanging fruit of outreach starts with schools, right? It starts with kids. I mean, come on. I mean, you guys have a captive audience. In terms of understanding trust and confidence, how to cultivate trust and confidence. So think of crisis communications as this. When you're in a crisis communications, your foot's on the gas, right? But when it's not a crisis communications, you're still coasting. Your foot's off the gas, but you're not hitting the brakes. You're still kind of coasting. You're still trying to invest in outreach. You're still trying to reach out to the community, build trust. So during downtime, everyone should be developing those relationships with the public, and that starts with younger age kids. Trying to basically get kids in the courts. Don't rely on. I think it's easy for us to kind of say, well, that's kind of the school's job to teach government. And really, I mean, they take the kids just by a show of hands, just out of curiosity. I mean, I know that a lot of schools take kids to like the state capitol. They usually take them to other, you know, visit like the legislature. But how many of your schools actually bring your kids to the courts? Great. I like seeing that. So part of what we're going to do is look at that. Outreach, try to build trust and understanding in the courts through like not just school tours, but also think about what kind of information you're conveying in those school tours. Are you teaching them about the actual structure of your courts, how the courts function, the purpose of the judiciary as opposed to the other two branches of the government, or are you teaching them about the history of the building and then kind of setting them free? Should be doing a little bit of both, right? A little bit of state history education, but also education about the role of the courts, how we, what our role is in terms of settling disputes within the framework of the law. But also other activities, because I mean, it's one thing to learn about what we do as courts in the classroom as just kind of this very abstract concept, but it really sinks in for students when it's put into action. And I'm not just talking about elementary school kids, I'm talking about high school, pre-law, even law students. But doing activities like mock trials is an essential component of doing that. You know, trying to get them to see how justice is in action. Mock trials are a perfect way of doing that because, I mean, they get to see, like, how evidence is handled, what are the rights of the defendant, how are those put into practice. So a couple of things, opportunities that we want to share with you are some of the things that we do in some of our courts that we want to also share. So one of the things that we do in the Utah State Courts is we basically offer a job shadowing opportunity once a year. It's called Judge for a Day. And we basically, this is in conjunction with Law Day. So every year the American Bar Association comes out with a Law Day theme. And I mean, I'm sure you guys also do your own events with Law Day. But what we do is we ask students of high school age to write an essay on Law Day. We have a panel of judges that review them. Those students that are selected, and really, it's a low bar. It's just an indication that they're interested, right? That's the whole point. But we then have judges volunteer, and they get to come, and they actually get to shadow one of our judges for an entire day. It's a one-on-one opportunity for a high school student to sit with alongside a judge in his or her courtroom and see how the courts work and function. We also encourage our judges to take them out to lunch also and just have that one-on-one opportunity. It's an amazing opportunity. I mean, I think outreach shouldn't necessarily be scared straight. It should outreach and education about the courts should also be inspiring. And so I understand that also Marianne has some information about the, what Nevada courts do.
Right, we have a mock trial program. A judge, it's more than a mock trial program, it's a court immersion program, and it has a mock trial component. Everybody does mock trials, I'm pretty sure, but this is, we had a judge that actually took a Harry Potter script and made it so that it fits fourth graders. We've opened it up to all the fourth graders across the valley. We bring them in, we partnered up with Project Real, which is a nonprofit. We bus the kids in, we, you know, kind of give them a little overview of the courts, get them upstairs, get them, they have costumes, Harry Potter costumes, they go through the trial. These kids are so excited about getting to play lawyer, judge, marshal. You wouldn't believe how many kids want to be marshals now. We got a whole force of cops in Vegas now because they did this mock trial. I ran into my hairdresser after one of the classes came through, and she said, oh, my son's in the elementary school. And I said, oh, maybe he did the mock trial program. And she said, oh my gosh, yes, he talked about it for days. He got to be the marshal, and now he wants to be a marshal. And he knows more about the justice system than I do. And so these kids are learning how to be jurors, they're learning how to be attorneys, they're learning how about law enforcement. We also, then the next year, they come in and sit through a judge's calendar. And I'm gonna tell you what, it's pretty scary when you see a 20-year-old sentenced to life. That makes a kid, an impact on a kid, and that's what we're doing. And we're, year after year, we have a program in place that educates them, and we do it in coordination with the nonprofit. And the kids are getting, these are children that have no, a lot of them have no influences in their life. They don't have, like a lot of them come from disadvantaged backgrounds. They need to see role models so they can see themselves as judge. And we tell the teachers, we do not want these kids typecast. If they're challenging in school, we want that kid to be the judge. Because when that kid sits in the judge's chair, they feel the part and they can see themselves in the part. And that's how we can inspire them to be the next generation and to get out of what might be a challenging system for them or a situation for them. But we do it year after year, and it's an immersion program. This pays big dividends down the line. And not only that, but it's great media opportunity. We use it for all our social media. We invite the media. We get a lot of coverage off that. And the judges enjoy it. They have a good time. So that's one of the things we're doing.
Craig also could talk about Florida's access to Civil Justice Commission.
Yes, Florida does a lot of things. Under the last Chief Justice, George Labarga, we set up an Access to Civil Justice Commission, which has been very active in Florida. It's really been looking at the sort of gap in civil legal justice. People who really can't afford a lawyer for that sort of thing and can't really get access to legal aid because they make a little too much money for that. So we've been working very hard in that area, put together some programs, put together a new telephone app containing the forms, the civil justice forms that we have that the Florida Supreme Court has approved for consumer use. This is one area that Florida really got very active in starting in the 1990s, and we've simply taken that to another level by putting it into a telephone app, making it more widely available. Those are some areas. We do many other forms of outreach as well. We also do the school kids. I have one of my staff positions is focused entirely on educational outreach. She handles our tour program. She goes out to schools and talks to them. She also manages a program where we bring teachers into the Florida Supreme Court from all around the state each year for a training program. We call it the Court Teaching Institute. It's financed largely by the Florida Bar with a cooperation of them and their staff, and so that's been very successful. Outreach is something that we really believe is an investment, not just in the future, it's an investment in public trust and confidence, and that's what we're in the business to look for. Thank you.
I think you had your hands raised.
Yeah, I didn't want to raise mine because you weren't ready for questions. Do any of you guys use the teen courts where you've got the teens come in and actually serve as the judge and the jury with a judge and advocates sort of overseeing it, and so when the kids get in trouble, they've got to serve on X number of teen courts as part of their punishment, in addition to whatever the jury hands, their teen jury hands down to them?
We have a trial by peers program, and the students, some of them are like, they're mandated to go to the program, and some of them are volunteers, but they have a student attorney. They basically run the whole thing. There's an actual real judge presiding, but the students are the attorneys. The students are decide the sentence, you know, and the whole thing. And it's a trial by peers. You get credit for it, or you, it can be part of your sentence if you're a juvenile offender.
And you guys have seen a lot of success from that. From what I've read on it, the kids are like, this is great. I didn't really understand the system, and now like this changes the way I look at everything.
It is effective. It is effective. And what we're trying to do with our programs in general is cut across the board at a younger age. We're looking at a younger demographic so that they're at their most... they're most willing to take in the information and absorb it, and we also are trying to do. We're trying to inspire kids. We want to inspire them to look outside their circumstances and also to look at what they could be, what they can achieve. And we sort of show the good and the bad. Like this is one path you could take, or this is another one. So a lot of what we do now is. Before they get to that point, but that's a great program too.
Craig, do any of the courts in Florida actually have a teen court or peer court?
Yes, in Florida it's largely based in the trial courts, which makes sense, of course, because you're dealing with sort of a trial-like situation. But it's been a very active program in our trial courts. Another one in Tallahassee. I've got lots of friends who've had their kids played the different roles in teen court. And it's inspired many of them to go into the law, to have a better sense of justice, and to really get themselves oriented in life. So you know, we found that to be a very successful program.
I mean, in Utah we do have a peer court. We have peer courts, plural. And I think it's just usually put on through the different school districts, and we're still trying to like settle on standards, as well as funding for that. But we're working on it as well. And as we go along, I mean, we're more than happy to entertain questions or discuss any issues that you guys might have. One of the things that was mentioned earlier is getting the teachers into your courts. So, I mean, in addition, how many of you guys are involved in your state's mock trial competition? Hopefully your states do have mock trial competitions. So I mean, that's one way to engage students is, and I've seen just kids just passionate and so excited as they spend like you know months preparing for mock trials, and it's such a sense of pride for them. So if our mock trial competition is actually put on by a nonprofit, a law related education nonprofit. Do you guys how's that handled through your courts?
Well, in Florida, we have a very active law-related education association. Annette Pitts, if any of you have ever heard of her, she's rather well-known around the nation, has been a godsend in things like that. But law-related education is very important, and of course, that's one thing that we cooperate very closely with because we believe law-related education is extremely important, and not just for the students, but also for the adults in the community. For teachers, for journalists, we aim for all of that. It's sort of a broad spectrum approach to outreach.
Getting, as I said before, just a while ago, getting teachers into your courts and educating them about it. We in the state of Utah, we're lucky to have a political science program that's very active. It's called the Hinckley Institute of Politics at the University of Utah. They hold during the summer months. They hold a 1 week. Intensive course for civics teachers, high school civics teachers from across our state. They get funding, they put them up, and they transport them, and they learn about all aspects of government. They meet with the governor, they meet the governor's office staff, they meet with the legislature, as well as they meet with us, and we give them a comprehensive guide and then about our structures of our courts and the purpose, and they get to ask us questions that they probably are not in the textbooks. And then we take them and have them observe live court, and it's for them, it's very informing, because then they get to see government come to life, right? I mean, they're stuck in the courtroom teaching from the teacher's manual. They actually get to see it come to life, and then we always, as far as we do, we always pick like an issue like school to prison pipeline or drug courts or something like that, special that they can be exposed to something kind of different.
Of course, we have a lot of programs along those lines too, and one of the things that we realize, I'm sure all of you are aware of this and can relate to this, the courts, if a lot of people don't understand the courts, they're a little bit, you know, mysterious to the public at large. They're not sure, like, is it district court? Is it, you know, muni court? Is it justice? There's a lot of confusion, misinformation. So when you don't understand something, it's easy to point at it and define it yourself. And usually when people do that, it's not a good definition. It's easy then to say, well, they don't do anything and this, that, and the other. So the more of these type of programs you can do, and there's so many out there, we have a PIO organization that cuts across the country. If you don't have a PIO, you know, we're always happy to help.
But Public Information Officer for anyone.
Yeah, right, CCPIO is the organization. We all have programs like this that are aimed at reaching out to the community, helping to clarify the courts in an interesting way that is beneficial. Again, it's about building relationships, building knowledge, and outreach to the community so that when times get tough, they kind of already have an idea of what you're doing.
Yes. 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 So, I mean, if you don't have somebody that coordinates school tours, it's kind of important to kind of centralize that process a little bit. But we invite all kinds of groups. In fact, a couple of months ago, one of our court clerks, she loves Trader Joe's. Who doesn't love Trader Joe's? But she just started talking to the general manager. Who knew that Trader Joe's actually has a program for their employees where they actually take them on field trips? And our clerk was like, come to the courts. We'll give you a tour of the courthouse or whatever. So we had like Trader Joe's staff come to the courts and learn about what we do. Senior groups, also continuing education through your local universities and colleges for people who are retired. Always. Just welcome anybody. Any opportunity you can get people to come. In a setting where they're not actually facing some sort of litigation or they have to make some sort of court hearing is a great opportunity.
Right now we have a program where we're trying to educate the community about jury service, because we would like to ensure that we're getting a diverse cross-section of our community, even though our jury numbers are good, but we'd like, you know, we're always improving. So we're doing an outreach to various communities across our valley to answer questions, to make them feel comfortable, to help them to understand what jury service is, why it's important, because you have to have a jury of your peers, and that's what we're going for, and we want to educate. But it's whatever the community is interested in. If they reach out to us, if it's a different issue, we're happy to accommodate. But jury service is one right now where we're really trying to cut across different, you know, areas of Las Vegas, or Clark County, I should say, to make sure that everybody gets the message about how important jury service is and answer any of their questions.
I think one, also it's important, if you have anybody that's like a law-related education coordinator or somebody that works with your schools and your courts, there's History Fair program. It's a nationwide program, History Fair, Science Fair. Don't just assume that those kids are not willing to be exposed to law as well. We've partnered with our state history fair coordinator and invited, sent information on opportunities for our education programs through their distribution list as well. Because I don't know what it is, but schools get inundated with all kinds of stuff, and it's really hard to kind of get into the classrooms.
It is.
Also, speakers bureaus. If you have any judges that are willing to actually go to the classroom and appear in the classroom and have students ask questions, is also a great opportunity. Also, I mean, in terms of, so we talked about kids, but I mean, in terms of like adults, continue, like I said, continuing education, but also journalists, think of your media. You need to be building trust with your local media, and one way to do that is provide a forum where they can ask open questions, where you can educate them on how things work. Try to nail down some of the more common misnomers, like, I don't know, how many of you get frustrated when you see somebody has been just arrested, not been charged, and they say, this person's been charged with murder or rape or something like that. This person's been charged, you know, has been charged with, and you're just like, no, they haven't. They have not been charged. There's definitely a knowledge gap there that can be filled with basically holding, like, it doesn't have to be a law school for journalists. That's pretty ambitious. But, I mean, I would encourage you to consider that. But, I mean, just holding a brown bag for members of the media.
Is that something where if, like, a reporter calls up and they're like, hey, I'd like to know about the courts, you sort of throw something together? Or do you have sort of like a program playbook in place that you reach out every so often to your local media and you're like, hey, just so you know, if you have any reporters that are interested in it, we have a reporters and the judicial system, like brown bag or course or shadow the judge day or something like that for them to learn about.
Go ahead, you want to talk about that in college?
I mean, we're starting to hold a brown bag seminar, it was a breakfast. We did it in conjunction with the bar, but we also got the local Society of Professional Journalists chapter on board to co-sponsor it, which kind of was a draw. So they actually helped us get more reporters to come, and we had judges represented from all levels of our courts. We're a unified system, so we had like justice courts, which are municipal courts, the trial courts, the juvenile courts, as well as the appellate court, and we had a discussion on media, on fairness, and just open it up to journalists to ask questions, like, because I'm sure journalists don't have time sometimes when they're on deadline, and they're just like, well, how does this work? And you'd be surprised some of the questions that come out from reporters, just because they're too afraid to ask, and you just provide a good venue for them to actually just open up and have just a very casual conversation about it.
How many here have court information officer or somebody who handles media in your court? Does anyone know? So it looks like a lot of courts don't. Here's the situation. The media today is under a lot of pressure, just like everybody else, but social media has changed the landscape tremendously. Their staffs are smaller. They're under a lot more pressure. They tend to go for a little bit, you know, if it bleeds, it leads, is the old saying, but it really holds true now because they have to really drive numbers to get ratings. So they're under a lot of pressure. Same with newspapers are struggling. Everybody's struggling. So anything you can do to make their lives easier, like a lot of them don't have time for training. They're going through. There's a lot of turnover. There's a lot of that. Recently, I called. I was talking to one of the news directors at the station. I said, hey, I'll come by. I'll talk to your reporters, I'll talk to your staff to kind of educate them about the courts. And they were like, would you? And I'm like, yeah, okay, no problem. So it just anything you can do to make the media's life easier. And if you don't have a PIO,
get one.
Get one.
But have somebody do it. I mean, I make it a personal policy that I meet with the TV stations and the major newspapers once a year. So I get myself invited to one of their like morning news meetings, and I just, you know, sometimes they want to ask questions, but I give them a rundown, because gone are the days where, you know, most news organizations can dedicate a single reporter to a court beat. I used to do that, but that doesn't happen anymore. And so they're just dumping people into the deep end of covering the courts, and when I do like orientation with our judges. That's also important, is that when you do new judge orientation, is to tell the judges, look, if you have a reporter in your courtroom and the hearing's over, just say, it's nice having you in the courtroom. Do you have any questions about what happened? I'd be more than happy to explain things to you. You don't have to comment on the case or anything else like that, but you can help them understand.
Yeah, and I would just like to follow up on that. We have reached a point in our society with news media where we can no longer depend on the news media to get out an accurate story of what courts do. Those days are gone. The internet completely pulled the rug out from under the traditional news business, and it's to some degree collapsing right now. One of the ways that we have addressed that in Florida, particularly at the Florida Supreme Court, is that we're very proactive now. We have all kinds of outreach programs that go on year-round with the news media. I have a law school for journalists. We call it our reporters workshop. Two-day session, we bring reporters in, pay them to come up. We train them on how to cover courts so that these new court beat reporters can have a better idea how to do it. We also are very proactive in following what the news, the reporters, the news business are doing. Have any of you heard of the term social media monitoring? It's sort of a new thing that's coming out. I have a friend who works for FEMA. He was in Tallahassee when we got hit by that last hurricane. And we went out to dinner, and he was telling me his job now has become nothing but social media monitoring. Well, I do that too. I use Facebook and Twitter, mainly Facebook, but Twitter also. I will follow what the press is doing, and if I see someone in the press going off track, I'll get in touch with them right away. Or, in some cases, I might even start pumping out my own material onto Facebook. We're very active on Facebook, so that I can get the story going back in the right direction. That's something that is now a continuous function of my office. We use Facebook to help shape the public opinion about the courts before the public opinion turns around and shapes us.
Yeah.
Is that activity 24/7? You turn it off at the end of the workday, or are you doing that overnight as well?
I do it overnight as well, because I'm on Facebook all the time. It's amazing. In 5 years, Facebook has gone from being something I rarely did to something I'm doing all the time. So really, I'm doing the monitoring up until I go to bed, then I turn it on when I get up in the morning.
Can I just respond to the woman who asked about, like, how do the reporters ask for law school for journalists, or you do it? And just in case anybody's a little bit intimidated by paying journalists for a two-day course, which is a lot, but a state Supreme Court can do. I work for the D.C. Superior Court, the trial court in D.C., well, I work for the D.C. courts. But the D.C. Superior Court does a law school for journalists, and I tell them it's like 2 hours instead of 3 years. And I, with all due respect to everybody who works in an appellate court, I don't go over anything about appellate courts unless there's a question. I go arrest to arraignment to trial to plea to sentencing. Like, I just follow the whole criminal process. Then we have, and I usually have it kicked off by the chief judge of our court. I have somebody from criminal division, hopefully a judge, tell them like how the criminal process works. Because let's face it, reporters rarely ask about a civil case. And then I'll have, you know, juvenile, how the juvenile process works, and maybe a little bit about our domestic violence process. And then I try to get in a few good words about any new innovative programs, any like our crime victims compensation program, anything that I want them to know. But it's 2 hours. I tend to do it early in the morning because if something happens, if I did it 11 to 1 and there's a big, you know, one car accident and I'm out of business. So I do it like 8 to 10 or 9 to 11 at the latest, and I have like coffee and donuts. But I just send out a press release and say, you know, here's what we're going to do. The chief judge will be there. That's usually a good draw. And then I have an agenda, like arrest to arraignment to disposition. So it doesn't take a lot. You can do it without the coffee and donuts. It doesn't take a lot of resources.
Doesn't hurt.
You just need to like line up the judges or the speakers. But it's actually a big help, because the person who covers the court today is not going to be the person at the arraignment next month.
And, and I think it goes without saying, I don't know how many of you actually conduct trust and confidence surveys, but when we do trust and confidence surveys, the vast majority of people get their information about the courts from media, from news, or, God forbid, law dramas and like Law and Order and that sort of thing, CSI. And the new one, there's a new show, is it The Judge or something? I can't remember. Anyway, it's terrifying.
Talking with those reporters, there's just something 2 days ago, a judge handed down a 45 days off time served for a rape. And so there's a whole news article was on that with one sentence, the court said we can't comment ethically on cases, which kind of sounds like you're hiding the ball. So how do you, like, what for the three of you, since you do have pretty active public information officers, how do you respond to something like that and sort of maintain that confidence that you're working to
fulfilled?
That's a good question. That's an education issue for the reporter. Is to make sure that they come into a courtroom understanding what the court's role is, and what the role is that the record speaks for itself, and just get them used to that. And it's more like it's an education program problem for the reporter, that they don't understand the role of the courts, and that's a symptom of that.
And one thing that I might say about that, one of my roles that I take very seriously is I keep in touch with the reporters. There are probably about 300 or 400 reporters that I keep in touch with, primarily on social media, but otherwise as well as phone calls, going to parties, going to press events. You know, a reporter has a book signing, I'll go to it. But one thing that comes from that relationship is if you end up in a situation like you are, I've got an existing relationship with those people. First of all, if the reporter's going to start writing bad stuff about my judge, they're going to feel an obligation to call me first because of our existing relationship. Second of all, if they write something that's really off the rails, I can call them up and I can talk off the record with them and say, you know, let me just gonna explain, not for publication, what's going on here so you can understand it a little better. And there are also other things as well. I keep a very close relationship with the editors and the other movers and shakers in the news business. I don't know if any of you have ever heard of a Florida Pulitzer Prize winning journalist named Lucy Morgan. Lucy is an old friend of mine since my days as a reporter before I went to law school, and I've kept in touch with her. Lucy was the mother hen to a bunch of journalists who now are all over the southeastern United States, and they look up to Lucy. And if I get one of Lucy's little proteges who has an issue or is writing something that one of my judges is not too happy with, I can call up Lucy and say, Lucy, can you tell me what's going on here? And half the time, Lucy might even call that reporter up herself and say, you know, you've got this kind of wrong. Let me just explain to you. So it's indirect, but it helps a lot.
It's, I mean, was the judge's sentence within, like, any sort of sentencing guideline?
You know, the article didn't talk about the sentencing guideline. So,
that may be one direction to point the reporter to. I also point the reporter to the fact, I mean, it's an adversarial system, right? Point the reporter to the defense attorney and say, you ought to talk to the defense attorney to get the other side of this situation. And you know, and then leave it to the defense attorney to say, yeah, it wasn't within the sentencing guidelines.
Okay.
I would also say you had mentioned new judge training. Mm-hmm. One of the things, and it's much more effective when an experienced judge is part of new judge training. And one of the things they will say is, in every sentence, what you say in the courtroom is all that you can say about why you're giving a sentence or why you're issuing an order. So make it really clear and easily understandable. And they'll also say, you may know at the time this is going to be controversial or there's a lot of, you know, people on both sides with strong views. But we had, not to give specifics, but we had a case where there was a contentious divorce. And, you know, that happens. We have a lot of cases with contentious divorces. But, like, a year later, somebody who had testified in favor of the wife, yes, the soon-to-be ex-wife, turns out that person was prominently featured in national news stories of a negative nature. So that divorce case then became like front page news, not front page, but national news. Things that the witness had said, because now the witness was in hot water. So you don't always know what case is going to be high profile. So there's really, having an experienced judge say, make sure, and like any time you know you're going to get criticism if somebody's got a plea deal and they're going to get a low end of a sentence, like make it really clear in the courtroom, because we can give out the transcripts. The PIO can give out the transcripts. That's our easiest. That's great.
And that's a good segue to, speaking of high profile, I want you to, we're going to watch this video, warning there's language, and I want you to imagine what you would do right after this.
It's running.
And there's no audio, of course. There we go.
All right. Looks like the state has filed a two-count information. One is battery domestic violence. The other is disorderly conduct. You have the public defender. This is Mr. Rodriguez, public defender. What do you want to do?
Pocket sound.
Tomorrow?
Your discretion.
Pay attention to what the defense attorney is
saying.
It's
going to expire before I can get them in, so.
It's not my emergency.
Question. You want to set it for trial?
You can set it for trial if you want to set it for trial instead. Sure.
Well.
I'm not waving. Am I waving?
That's easy.
The answer is,
that's
I'm
easy.
Not waving.
Just say it.
Okay, I'm not waving.
I don't care.
I don't care either. I'm not waving.
I just needed to set it for a date.
Well, normally we go to docket zoning after that. If you want to go to trial, we'll set it for trial. That's fine.
All right. Speedy trial. That is June 9th at 8:30. All right, that's a mandatory court date for you. You don't want to be late that day. If you haven't talked to your lawyer, you need to get it done, right? All right. Sir. You're Mr. Runkles?
Yes, sir.
Two charges, assault and resisting. You have the public defender. Public defender, what do you want to do?
But they filed?
They have.
I'm not waiting.
All right. What do you want to do?
What do you want to do? I'm not waiting. You want to set it for trial, set it for trial.
All right.
If you want to set it for docket signing, set it for docket signing. I'm not waiting in any case. This is an emergency created by the state.
If I had a rock, I would throw it at you right now.
You know, this
stop pissing me off. Just sit down. I'll take care of it. I don't need your help.
No,
sit down.
You know, I'm the public defender. I have a right to be here, and I have a right to stand
and
represent
my clients.
I said,
sit down. If you want to fight, let's go out back, and I'll just beat your ass.
Keep in mind, court pages, they're listening to this. Okay, just for the sake of time. The judge does come back and takes the bench and has to catch his breath. And the courtroom just kind of breaks into applause, but. All right, so this happens in your court. What do you do? How do you keep this particular incident isolated and keep it from spreading to the rest of the trust and confidence of the rest of your court and the rest of your judges? What's your idea? What's the first idea that comes to mind?
The South Cop judges are human. I have not seen any handle of it, but there is an element that judges are human. They do get frustrated. Yes, they have to have a certain demeanor and composure when they take the bench. We have a high expectation of that, but they also are human. And I'm not saying that was the right response.
Okay.
This is off the cuff.
Sure.
But I mean,
behind you.
I would think that it would be addressing court decorum rules. We have those where I am in the state, and just saying, this is what is required, and just leave it at that point, because we don't know what the investigation is going to show, you don't know if maybe this judge has had other issues in the past, mm-hmm. they just bring up the general rules of the forms that we should start.
Okay.
I think I'd say that we find the video troubling, and that we're looking into it, and we're going to make sure that if any of our court rules or our ethical rules are violated by either the attorney or the judge, that we're going to make sure that they're addressed properly, because the integrity of the court system and the process is one of the most important things to us. And that if, you know, the public can't trust us, then we've got nothing. So we're going to make sure we get to the bottom of it.
Yeah, and I like where you're going with that. Accountability really matters at this point, right? But Greg can explain to you what happened in this particular case.
Yeah, this actually happened in Brevard County, Florida. I got a phone call that shortly after that happened from the public information officer down there, and she said, one of my judges just beat up a defense lawyer. And we kind of dealt with it from there. But every court administrator's nightmare is that one of your judges does something like this on a slow news day. That's kind of what happened to Michelle Kennedy, the public information officer there. First issue we faced was whether this video was public record. Under Florida law, it is. So we released it right away. I told Michelle, do not hold it back. It's public record. We're not going to put up a fight over it because the law's clear. You may have different records laws in your state, but this went out. As soon as it went out, all of a sudden, next thing we knew, I was getting calls from London about the fighting judge in Brevard County. And Michelle and I, the PIO down there, spoke quite a lot. She worked with her chief judge, and they put together a statement that was released to the press in which they recognized that, you know, this was problematic, and they said that the chief judge did not countenance this kind of behavior by any judge. It was a simple statement. It didn't go very deeply. There were some ethical and legal issues here as well. This judge was later brought up on ethics charges, could have faced, of course, criminal charges for assault and battery as well, although it didn't go there. So we were walking a tightrope on this one. But when the statement came out of Brevard County about this, it was instantly picked up by news media, even the big news media in New York City. And one of the national networks actually showed an image of the statement from the court. It quelled the issue pretty well, although this judge was in hot water, of course, and eventually lost his job over the whole thing. But the action of the chief judge in Brevard County stopped this cancer from spreading further into the rest of the court system. We at the Supreme Court level are very concerned about this because we have a unified state court system in Florida. And so ultimately, the buck stops at my chief justice's office, and he comes walking into mine. So I thought this was handled about as well as it could have, given the fact of the public records issues and the public trust and confidence issues that we were facing here.
Thanks, Greg. And I mean, there's also all kinds of other types of disasters. I mean, and what we want to just kind of cover is not only, like, you know, a judge that gets in a fist fight with, or wraps her fingers around the throat of a staff member.
Yeah, just last week we had that in Florida.
Yeah. Florida.
you've heard of Florida Man? Weird Florida stories?
Yeah.
A friend of mine, Craig Pittman, actually wrote a book about that, and he's made a fortune off of it.
Yeah, just Google Florida Man. It's
Florida
kind
Man
of a
challenge.
The Florida Man challenge, exactly.
Your birthday and yeah. Google Florida Man and your birthday.
I kind of a close second is Utah. we get all kinds of stuff. We actually had a defendant who was facing drug charges, who just didn't want to come to court. And so what he would do is, the first time he picked up the phone and he called in a bomb threat on the day he was supposed to go to court. That forced the evacuation of our courthouse, threw off jury trials, all kinds of stuff. We had to have, like, you know, bomb sniffing dogs go through the entire courthouse, everything. So everything got continued to the next week. So it was on a Thursday. Guess what happened next week? Got another bomb threat. 3 weeks in a row, we had this person call a bomb threat. The police finally caught him and his girlfriend, and they faced felony charges for it. But, I mean, communicating that to the public that the courthouse is shut down, that if you have a hearing, it's important to stay connected to your community, because if you have a hearing that day and the courthouse has been evacuated, you're going to want to know, am I going to get in trouble because I didn't show up? Who am I supposed to tell when everybody's like out on the lawn or across the street or whatever? Who am I supposed to tell? And so we put out information about where to call, what to do, you know, make sure that you call into the courts and make sure that you get your hearing, know when your next hearing date is. We apologize for this happening. Also, working with law enforcement, I mean, if you have an evacuation, Central Command is usually sent up, right? So the police are in charge of the incident command and investigation. You're still in charge of your court staff. And this particular incident with the bomb threats, we had the lead officer on incident command basically tell the media that the courthouse was closed for the rest of the day and that all employees were supposed to go home. Not your call. You may be in charge of the investigation, you may be in charge of the safety of everybody around you, but we're still in charge of court operations, and so we need to coordinate with that. So make sure that there's somebody from your AOC or an administrator there at incident command working with law enforcement.
When you had those like bomb threats and things had to be rescheduled, were your judges more lenient with people who didn't show up for those rescheduled hearings?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, because we recognize that it threw everybody's schedules and everybody's all kinds of cases into a little bit of turmoil. It took some time to have those waves kind of settle down.
So that was something that like your chief judge issued out through the court, like, hey, maybe don't enter bench warrants or people don't show up off of this bomb.
Yeah, we worked with the presiding judge to make sure that, you know, in terms of warrants, but also like we had inmates, you know, that had to be like bust out, you know, because of the bomb threat and everything. So just all those logistics have to take place, and we encourage the court administrator for that courthouse be working with the presiding judge actively to get everything back up and running.
I have a question. How many here know whether or not your court has social media? Are you? Because that's essential in a situation like this. It literally, the media is on social media. So you put one post up and it's out like that. So that's a very important tool. Like Craig said earlier, the social media is where it's at right now. If you're not on social media, you're missing half of your audience. So just...
And Craig's got a good perspective with Bush v. Gore. Craig's got a great history with the courts in dealing with one of the most difficult and most contentious issues that the state of Florida has ever faced. But then he can contrast that with the last presidential election and how social media kind of changed that.
The Bush v. Gore, of course, happened before social media existed. So we handled that a little differently. We learned a lot of lessons from that as well. Through the years as social media has come along, we've been adopting that as a way of dealing with crisis communications because it has become more effective than any other method we have used. One thing, we used to be able to rely on the newspapers in Florida to print at least a little blurb of an announcement about what was going on in the courts. They don't do that anymore. They don't have the money. They're not going to listen to me. So if I need to get out crisis information, I'm going to go to Facebook and Twitter. Maybe throw up an Instagram to draw some more attention over to my Facebook account or to my website. Those are the kinds of things we do. Now, I'll tell you something. You mentioned Bush v. Gore. Back during Bush v. Gore, one of our problems was how to get information from inside the courthouse to outside the courthouse without looking like idiots. The only way we could do that was to start making announcements to the media that I was going to walk out onto the front steps in 30 minutes and make an announcement about the court ruling about who was going to be the president of the United States. And let me tell you, that was one of the scariest 36 days of my life going out there. Police offering me a bulletproof vest and dealing with hecklers while I'm on live worldwide television. Today, I would do that on Twitter. And I wouldn't even have to leave the courthouse. I can get it from inside the courthouse to outside the courthouse on Twitter, and I don't need a bulletproof vest for that. So that's one way that we deal with this. During the hurricanes we've had in Florida over the last several years, including Michael, which did a grazing blow to Tallahassee, We use that to get out emergency information to the public. The great thing about Facebook and Twitter is that they are viral in nature. By viral, I mean that people share. It's kind of like word of mouth, except it's on the internet. One of the things that we do is we have a lot of people who cooperate with us, a lot of bar organizations, a lot of community organizations. If we put out some information about courthouses being closed by a hurricane or a tornado or whatever, they're going to start sharing that with their members, and it just starts growing and growing and growing as people share and share and share, and I can get it out faster that way than I used to be able to do when the newspapers were flush with cash. So right now, as far as I'm concerned, for crisis communications, if you don't have Facebook and Twitter, you are hobbling yourself in your ability to deal with crises.
Sorry, you had a question.
Do you tweet out your crisis stuff? Do you just tweet to your followers, or do you tweet and tag like the local news stations and then retweet your tweets to different community groups to try to speed up that spread of the information, or you just let it
Well, it largely evolves naturally. We will use hashtags. If you know, if there's an established hashtag going on right now, you know, about whatever the crisis is, we'll use that so that people can go and search it. You know, that's a wonderful way to make it easier to find the information. And I can tell you, you know, if Bush v. Gore happened today, not only would we be using hashtags, we might even be using what in today's world is called event branding. And event branding means you come up with your own graphic image that's like a brand for that particular event. We had a wonderful session a few years back, City of Orlando. They dealt with the Pulse nightclub shooting, which had everybody in the community and around the world focused on Orlando. They had a communications problem like you would not believe. They used event branding so that they had this logo of what was going on with the City of Orlando and their response to this horrible, horrible tragedy in their community. And because they had that image, people could who are scrolling through Facebook or Twitter, they see the image and they know that was what they had come looking for. So event branding is another way of making it easier for people to find that.
So as always, the function of the PIO is essentially like what you see up here. We're a single point of contact. Messaging, staying on message and having one message is important, especially in a crisis. Ensuring that your PIO is kept in the loop, making sure that they're briefed regularly on what's going on is also important. And as always, the CCPIO is a great network for your PIOs. If your PIO is not a member of CCPIO, we would encourage them and you to have them become members. We have a great listserv of professional court communications professionals that you can put out any issue. That, I mean, they can put out any issue, and you have like so much experience out there that you can just put it out there and people will respond with suggestions and ideas. So I know we ran a little over, but we will be more than happy to stick around and answer any questions that you might have. But thank you so much. Hopefully we've given you some information that you guys can take back to your courts and help you further connect with your communities. Thank you.